Thank you. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 23806 in the name of Miles Briggs on Princess Alexandra by Pavilion. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to put R in the chat function? I call on Miles Briggs to open the debate. Mr. Briggs, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I start by thanking the MSPs who have signed my motion to enable me to hold this members' debate this evening. I'd also like to thank and pay tribute to those organisations who have provided useful briefings ahead of tonight's debate, and also to thank them for the work that they do to support blind and visually impaired people and their families and carers here in Lothian, but also across Scotland. And I think I speak for Edinburgh and Lothian representatives when I say that the decision by SNP ministers to cut £45 million of funding from NHS Lothian for the replacement Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion came out of the blue and is very concerning. I know from the significant number of emails and messages which I've already received from constituents that any decision to remove and close eye services in Edinburgh will not be acceptable. The initial agreement document on the redesign of eye services in NHS Lothian, including the reprovision of the eye pavilion, published by NHS Lothian in 2018, makes clear that the current facilities at the eye pavilion are no longer fit for purpose and indeed need to be replaced. In recent years, very significant numbers of NHS Lothian patients have received treatment in the local private sector due to there being insufficient capacity within existing services. It's clear that a replacement eye pavilion is indeed needed to ensure that NHS Lothian is capable of meeting current and future demand and to improve the efficiency and throughput of ophthalmology theatres, which is currently not feasible at the eye pavilion. NHS Lothian initially evaluated 9 different options for future service provision, establishing a new hospital at the Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh, Edinburgh BioQuarter site. It was evaluated as the optimal proposal and also scored highly when the appraisal on other key appraised against other key areas. These included research space so that more patients can be recruited into clinical trials, leading to better treatments and ultimately greater clinical effectiveness. The co-location with good research and teaching facilities, helping to attract and retain the best clinical staff, and reduce travel between sites, increasing available time for important clinical care. The business case for the reprovision of the eye pavilion sets out other ambitions which I believe are essential to meet the current and future needs of people living with sight loss in Lothian and the east of Scotland, that it should be a purpose-designed facility to make best use of resources, bringing significant improvement in the patient and carer experience, the result in an improved ability to respond to digital imaging developments and aid diagnosis and clinical reviews. As the RNIB briefing for this evening's debate makes clear, ophthalmology is already Scotland's largest outpatient specialty. Demand for eye health services continues to increase, with more people waiting longer to be seen. Preventing avoidable sight loss is a priority for all Scottish health boards, the Scottish Government and all political parties. Around 178,000 people live with a significant degree of sight loss in Scotland today, around 4,300 of which are children and young people. This number could eventually double unless we act to prevent avoidable sight loss. So vital local services are critical. NHS Lothian and the East of Scotland has the fastest growing population in the country. And we know that along with an ageing population, we'll see additional eye care needs placed on our health service in the future. In fact, NHS Lothian's initial impact assessment on the redesign of eye services concluded that the reprovision of the eye pavilion reported a projected 20% increase in demand for new and reviewed outpatient appointments between 2020 and 2030. That was just Lothian-wide. And between 2013 and 2030, we are expecting a 42% rise in the demand of projected service use, inpatient and surgical day cases, of which approximately 80% will be cataract surgery. Now, I welcome the additional surgery capacity which ministers have outlined at the new elective centre in St John's in Livingston, but this will also be for other health boards to access and will not in any way provide for the closure or replacement of the eye pavilion. Presiding Officer, on too many occasions over the last 13 years, decisions by SNP ministers to centralise and cut services have been taken, I believe, without real clinical or patient consultation. I've already outlined my concerns to the Cabinet Secretary, and I welcome the positive engagement she's had with me so far on this issue, but I fear we're already seeing that happening with regards to the Eye Pavilion. As Site Scotland, in their briefing for today's debate, also states, Edinburgh and Scotland has the potential to be a world leader in eye health research, and for the new eye hospital in Edinburgh, linking to existing academic and research institutions here in the capital to help progress that goal. The pioneering research into eye disease and clinical research at the Eye Pavilion is of vital importance and must be protected. This is groundbreaking work, and we must make sure we take that forward. Deputy Presiding Officer, I wanted to bring this debate forward today because as we find ourselves in this lockdown, in the middle of a pandemic, with Parliament and public and the public finding it even more difficult than ever to scrutinise decisions, I believe we need the Cabinet Secretary to pause, to rethink the closure and replacement of the Eye Pavilion. I'd like ministers to agree to undertake an independent assessment of all options. It would be totally unacceptable for Scotland's capital to lose its eye hospital, and indeed for Edinburgh to become one of only a few UK cities not to actually have an eye hospital. I hope the Cabinet Secretary will today take on board these concerns and understand the impact and the unintended consequences which these decisions can have on patients, their families and their carers, as well as the highly professional, highly valued professionals who currently work at our Eye Pavilion here in Edinburgh. Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I look forward to hearing other colleagues' contributions this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs, and I call Sarah Boyack to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am very grateful to Miles Briggs for bringing this debate today in the Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion in Edinburgh. The issues he's raised in his motion, such as the worries about safety for patients attending the pavilion, the waiting times, and the chronic underfunding of NHS Lothian, reinforce how important it is for the Scottish Government to fund a replacement for the Eye Pavilion, not give up on it. And I hope this debate will provide convincing arguments to reverse the decision, as it will have a detrimental impact on our constituents right across the Lothians. And I imagine, like other members in this debate, I have had numerous constituents reach out to me concerned and worried about the withdrawal of the £45 million that's needed for the new Eye Pavilion. As RNIB say in their excellent briefing, it was all set to go ahead in spring last year, and NHS Lothian announced the contract on their website, saying that the £45 million construction contract is part of a £68.5 million project procured through the Health Facility Scotland framework, will replace the existing Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion in Edinburgh City Centre, which opened in 1969. And they went on to say, it's expected that the new hospital will support the delivery of a quality eye service to approximately 84,000 outpatients per year and will carry out nearly 12,000 operations per year by 2030. So we really need to know what's changed, what's happened to the contract. As one friend who got in touch in advance of today's debate said, I cannot stress enough that location in a central place is so important for eye medicine, emergency treatment by eye specialists and clinic. Her experience, personally, was that sight loss can happen very fast, the detached retina dying in a short space of time, so fast access to medical treatment is vital. Her brother attended the Edinburgh Eye Pavilion at 3 a.m. in the morning when he was in Edinburgh about 4 years ago because his eye was hemorrhaging. And being able to see an eye specialist at that time was so important. His journey to Laurison Place took about 15 to 20 minutes. He was treated, given meds and reassured. And some constituents have been in touch to talk about the pressures of having to travel to the Golden Jubilee in Glasgow, given that driving's obviously not possible following an eye treatment in most cases, or when living with the side effects of an eye problem. This is a journey which forces them to navigate multiple buses and trains to access NHS services. So it isn't good enough. And according to Sight Scotland, there are 14,500 people living with sight loss in Edinburgh and nearly 12,000 people with sight loss living across the rest of the Lothians. And they expect there to be a further 3,000 people living with sight loss in Edinburgh by 2030. But cannot be right that those living with sight loss are unable to access services in their local area. This is an issue which is wider than just the physical access to healthcare. Early access to effective treatment, ongoing specialist primary care, and hospital treatment are crucial to ensuring people have the support they need to live well with sight loss. RNIB highlight the rise in sight-threatening conditions such as diabetes and an ageing population, which will increase the number of people affected by sight loss unless action is taken. So we need to ensure that moving out of this pandemic, we're not removing services from those who need it most. That is austerity, and it's failed across the UK, and we cannot have it in Scotland. Removing vital services from those who are vulnerable is no way for us to move forward. And I appreciate the Scottish Government is facing huge challenges, but it has also overseen the funding, the underfunding of NHS Lothian over the years via the NRAC funding model. The removal of this funding, this 45 million, falls short of protecting my constituents. It needs to be reversed as soon as possible. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Daniel Johnson, please. Mr. Balfour can't hear you. I'll come back to you, Mr. Balfour. Have you? No, still can't hear you. I'll come back. I'll take Daniel Johnson. And what you do is to log off, Mr. Balfour, and log back on again. Right, I'll take Daniel Johnson, please. Mr. Johnson, I saw you a moment ago. There you are.
Is that me, Presiding Officer?
Yes, it is.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm thankful that I'm not delivering this speech by mime, given the way I had to vote yesterday, so I sympathise with Mr. Balfour. But I'm very thankful to Miles Briggs for securing this debate, because it's hugely important. Edinburgh's Eye Pavilion, its specialist eye surgery unit, is hugely important to all the people that have had to use it in recent years. But what's more, I don't think this is a debate that would be happening if this was any other service. I don't believe that people would stand for the loss of cancer treatment services from Edinburgh. I don't believe they would stand for the loss of heart surgery or any other specialist surgery or specialist treatment from this city. So why is it eye specialism any different? And the things that the Eye Pavilion does are truly outstanding. They perform miracles. They restore people's sight. My friend John, I discovered just in recent months, had surgery performed at the Eye Pavilion following a detached retina, saving his sight. We cannot lose this specialism from the city. And we have to truly question the impacts of the dispersed model that's being proposed, a model that will see specialist surgeons apparently travel to localities to deliver their services rather than performing their highly skilled operations in a familiar place. We have to question whether the disruption to people who will have to travel to different places rather than the central location that they're familiar with, people who have lost much of their sight, who cannot drive for obvious reasons. And we have to question what the impact will be of losing the critical mass of expertise and skills. Because we know that it's critically important for specialisms that people do perform these as much as possible, that bringing people together, having them perform more of these procedures than less, means that they are better able to deliver successful outcomes for their patients. And ultimately, this does appear to be a consequence of cost cutting. This is £45 million, which is a drop in the ocean of health spending. And it's clearly not the preferred option of the Health Board. As Miles Briggs set out, there was a clear business plan, announcements made, other announcements setting out how this would improve healthcare for people needing eye treatment. So it's not their preferred option, and it's not the preferred option of the professionals and surgeons themselves, who've made it very clear that this is not an option that they favour, who don't want to travel and fear the loss of expertise from the centre of excellence. Indeed, as Miles Briggs pointed out, this will leave Edinburgh as one of the very few UK cities without a specialist eye hospital or unit. And surely that cannot be tolerated. But ultimately, this is a major change in the clinical model. And where's the evidence? Where's the evidence that this will deliver what's needed? Where's the consultation with the people who provide these services or who use these services? Where's the negotiation with ophthalmologists and optometrists? And what are the implications? What will the impacts be of the closure of this central eye specialist unit? What we are seeing is the destruction of a center of excellence through budgetary reasons. A major change in clinical delivery, but without any substantial strategy or national consultation. And we have to ask, how many people will have to lose their sight because of the loss of this key specialist service from this city? So I thank Miles Briggs for bringing this motion to Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson. And I'll try again with Jeremy Balfour. Mr. Balfour.
Deputy Presiding Officer, can you hear me now?
We have liftoff, Mr. Balfour. We have liftoff.
Thank you. And can I thank Miles Briggs for bringing this debate to the Parliament this evening? His motion notes that the Scottish Government is not in a position currently or in the foreseeable future to fund a much needed new eye hospital for NH Lothian Health Board. The current hospital was opened in 1969 and was deemed unfit 6 years ago. Back in 2018, an initial agreement was made and approved by NHS Scotland, and work was due to begin in March last year. But yet 2 years later, nothing has happened, and all of a sudden, the government announced that no funding is no longer available. This setback will have numerous complications for patients requiring care and treatment for their eye health in the Lothian area. Considering my early diagnosis and treatment is the best way to prevent sight loss. As we've heard already, there's been talk of services moving to Livingston. However, this has been a very recent development, and this centre was not part of the original plan. For patients with problems with their eyes, this will mean additional unnecessary travel for treatment, which will result in either using more buses or trains or taxis. The current building, which I visited recently on Chalmers Street site, has a maintenance cost that is exceeding budget and has many faults, including the roof, which needs a major repair, which also means that there is an inadequate accessibility because lifts keep breaking within the building. Staff find it difficult to park, let alone patients, and there's also a worry about due to the lack of space, confidentiality when meeting with patients. A reallocation to the Edinburgh BioQuarter site, currently the home of the Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh and the Royal Hospital for Children and Young People at some point, would ensure a continuity of care from admission to treatment and then outpatient services. The building would be better for patients, it would be better designed and would meet the needs. There needs to be scope within the building to account for the numbers that we're likely to see increase here in Lothian over the next 10 years, predicted to be an increase of around about 25% for the number of outpatients and up to 40% increase for those requiring surgery, as well as in continued development in the digital imagery and technology for care for the eye. In his motion, my colleague Miles Briggs makes reference to the fact that NHS Lothian has been continually underfunded by the formula for the health board funding in Scotland. It is time for the government to give NHS Lothian a fair share of the funding available for health to ensure a new fit for purpose and modern eye hospital is built to give the people of the Lothian area the best care within the community. Overall, I believe the need for a new eye hospital in Edinburgh should be a priority for the health budget for the Scottish Government, as to ensure that the people of Lothian area have the best possible care for their eye health and to stop leaving us behind compared to other regions in Scotland. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Balfour. And I call Alec Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Neil Findlay. Mr. Cole-Hamilton, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I join the chorus of approval for Miles Briggs in taking time to make members' business available for this very, very important matter? Christophe Insight Loss Group are one of the most formidable collections of individuals you would ever be likely to meet. They love their Ivy Pavilion, and I have visited them a couple of times, and they have put me through my paces. But for them, the convenience of having one in our nation's capital is palpable. That is from where their appreciation of the convenience of that service comes. And they are concerned, and this is their words, and I've talked to them extensively about this, not just through casework, but because, you know, I've come to become quite friendly with them, that, as they say, for our nation's capital to lose this eye hospital represents asset stripping on a massive scale. It's been said several times in this debate that we would become one of the only major cities to not have a dedicated eye care facility. As we've heard several times, the current premises on Chandler Street was opened in 1969. It is now clearly not fit for purpose, but it is much loved within our nation's capital. We all know people who rely on it. We all know people who've used it in an emergency. I was very nearly shipped up there myself back in 2011 when my toddler eye gouged me in a particularly rambunctious bout of horseplay and scratched my lens with a deeply unsanitary fingernail. Thankfully, I was actually able to be treated by our nearest optician, but it was a near-run thing. It was reassuring to me to know that it was there. So when it was classed as unfit for purpose, NHS Lothian embarked on a considerable capital procurement project. As we've heard, there were 9 different options considered, and indeed, lots of work went into the tenders, and the initial agreement for this new hospital was signed off by NHS Scotland as long ago as February 2018, before construction contract company was given a contract for it in July of the same year. And yet, out of the blue, NHS Lothian said at the start of January they'd been informed by the Scottish that they would no longer be funding the £45 million replacement. And it's not entirely clear why this is, and I hope that the Minister will give some reassurance to members in their closing remarks that there is no link between this decision and what has happened in the hemorrhage of public cash through the Sick Kids debacle, because the confluence of these two things is uncanny and troubling, and I would like that clarified for the record. Presiding Officer, when you have sight loss, familiarity of location really matters. For Jean Freeman to suggest that elective treatment centre could be built in Livingston is devastating to people with sight loss in our community. As I say, when you have sight loss, that familiarity of location really matters, because the orbit of your universe can be delineated in part by your journeys up for treatment or consultation at the hospital. You know what buses to get, you know where to get off, you know what road infrastructure and road furniture exists between you and that building. You're going to have to learn a whole new suite of travelling to order to access a new facility out in West Lothian. Optometrists known to me personally refer to this decision as a disaster. And as we know, demand for quality eye care is only growing with the city's growth as well, and with the ageing population. Miles Briggs, I support his calls for an independent consultation on the future of the Eye Pavilion. But I will close with this. I mean, I think one of the most compelling interventions I've seen in this debate and the future of the Eye Pavilion is around that of charity Sight Scotland. The business case for replacing the hospital is utterly compelling, and it scored highly in terms of research base, so that more patients could be recruited into clinical trials, leading to better treatment. Again, why would we remove that opportunity from citizens within our nation's capital? And I will finish with their words. They say, we are concerned that not proceeding with the new eye hospital will not support the best access to treatment for patients. Also risk the potential Edinburgh has to be a world leader with research and development in eye health. Presiding Officer, I hope that the government will listen to the cross-party calls this evening for them to rethink this ill-fated decision and reinstate plans to design and build a new state-of-the-art eye care facility in Edinburgh. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Neil Findlay, please.
I'm pleased Miles Briggs has brought forward this debate tonight. Several speakers have covered the background to the issue, so I won't repeat any of it. But I want to stress that this situation is just the latest in a long, long line of debacles within the NHS Lothian area, caused by the Scottish Government's running of our greatest public service, the National Health Service. And if we look at the Audit Scotland report, only 2 out of 8 waiting times were being met pre-COVID. Just this week, I've been advised that waiting time to see a psychologist in the NHS Lothian area is 24 months. That is absolutely unacceptable. And this is the same across many disciplines. Of the £207 million black hole in the NHS budget, almost half of it is for NHS Lothian. So is this the reason why there has been the cancellation of this project? And we're still paying. We are still paying £1.4 million a month for the sick kids hospital that has not treated a single patient. What a scandal that is. And the children's ward at St John's is still not operating on a 24/7 basis, 7 years on from the start of the problem. And now let me say this to people who are campaigning for the eye hospital. If you do not run a campaign, if you do not run a diligent, vigorous campaign, this will be steamrolled, it will be closed. That's the lesson from the St John's Children's Ward time. And we now see the government refusing to fund this project. This was a government elected on the platform of keep healthcare local. Remember that? Well, for some people, healthcare will be local if it's in Livingston, and that's a good thing. I believe in local healthcare. But if you are someone who's travelling from the borders or you're travelling from East Lothian, then healthcare will not be local. If you are someone travelling from, say, Dunbar by train, it would take you 2 hours to get to Livingston and a 45-mile journey. Presiding Officer, Lothian is the fastest growing population area in Scotland, with another 133,000 people expected to be living there by the mid-century. There are 26,000 with sight loss in the region. That will increase dramatically. And a 50-year-old facility simply cannot cope with that volume of demand, and it cannot even cope with current demand. We need a funding formula for the NHS that reflects population growth and that accepts and remedies the fact that we have tired and inadequate infrastructure that everyone says is not fit for purpose. And is the Minister happy? I hope she will respond to this. Is the Minister happy that more public money is leaking out of the NHS into the private sector by trying to deal with this situation regarding eye care? I hope she will respond to that in her reply. We need an NHS fit for the 21st century, and we need services that are modern and are able to cope with the demands of them. I hope that there will be a huge public reaction to this. I hope that we will see anonymous civil servants and others who are advising ministers exposed, and that this decision will be overturned.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finlay. I now call on Marie Goujon to close for the government. Minister, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to Miles Briggs for raising the important issue. And I know from all the contributions that we've heard tonight just how strongly and passionately people feel about this, and I absolutely appreciate that. And that's why I want to give members an update on how we are improving services. Now, during the pandemic, there's been amazing innovation in what can be delivered remotely and in community settings. And the establishment of the Lothian Emergency Eye Care Treatment Centre in a matter of days in April was really testament to the skills and willingness of the workforce to deliver outstanding care. And they really do deserve our thanks for that. But this rate of change has only been possible because of the work that was already underway to modernise and improve services. And we've seen fundamental changes in recent times in how eye care services is delivered. Now, one really positive development is that lower risk patients can now be safely reviewed in virtual clinics. They can enjoy quality care and the convenience of being seen locally. And many more patients are now being cared for by highly qualified optometrists in their own communities. So just as an example of that, as a response to the pandemic, an additional 7,125 people in Lothian with long-term conditions will be reviewed by community optometrists over the next 6 to 9 months. A flexible approach is being used in NHS Lothian, where optometrists are supporting the existing workforce within hospital eye services, as well as reviewing some patients within community practices. NHS Lothian is also supporting a national pilot study to safely discharge lower-risk glaucoma patients to accredited community optometrists. And that, again, will provide an excellent service to patients, which is also much closer to home. New technology is also changing what facilities are required to carry out in terms of some eye surgeries. So, for example, a cataract treatment theatre is being used in NHS Grampian for local anaesthetic cataract surgeries. And with our investment in the new elective care centre in Livingston, NHS Lothian can significantly increase its theatre capacity for more complex procedures. So really, what is needed from an eye hospital now and in the future has fundamentally changed, and that's why we've needed to look again at the Eye Pavilion proposal. Now, the cost of that proposal was large. It was £83 million, not the £45 million as the motion suggests. And as I've outlined already, there are new, better and more efficient ways of providing eye care requirements. So we've asked NHS Lothian to look again at its plans for eye care services and what it can do with its existing estate and the new elective care centre in Livingston. We've demonstrated our readiness to invest in infrastructure where it is the right thing to do. However, we'll have to be sure that our investments are justified by need. Now, with the level of change and innovation that's happening just now, we no longer think it is. Now, I completely understand that this decision will be disappointing to some people, but I hope that the Parliament would understand the need to make the best use of resources and to keep our investment decisions under review, as well as keeping costs under control. Now, I know that waiting times was a point that's been raised. I think it was Neil Finlay that mentioned that. I absolutely regret that waiting times, including for eye surgery, have increased, and I think we've seen that increase significantly over the course of the last year. And I think that colleagues would appreciate that this is one of the consequences of the pandemic. Now, we're committed to reducing waiting times as part of the NHS recovery from the COVID pandemic. But building a new eye hospital, which wouldn't be ready for almost 4 years at the earliest, just wouldn't reduce those waits. Now, the most effective ways to reduce those waiting times are through the measures that I've already outlined in the comments so far. That's by bringing more services being provided by community optometrists, using greater use of virtual clinics. There's the expansion of the use of new technology, as well as increasing our elective surgery capacity. Now, I know that it was mentioned in the motion by Niles Briggs, as well as by a few other members tonight, about the NRAC model. Now, the Scottish Government's approach has been to move health boards towards their NRAC share gradually over a number of years. Now, to move NHS Lothian to its NRAC share would require an equivalent reduction in funding for other boards. And I would also highlight that that formula is an objective measure. It's updated annually, and it's not clear on what other objective measure NHS Lothian should receive more or at whose expense that should be. And I would also add that NRAC is simply not relevant to the funding of major infrastructure projects, which are funded and prioritised, and that's done on the basis of need for investment. So the NRAC formula isn't used for them. Now, I've already mentioned the new elective care centre in Livingston. That will provide elective surgery in a much more convenient location for the residents of West Lothian and help provide the elective surgery capacity that they need for the future. And that's not the only example of the Scottish Government's investment in Lothian's health infrastructure. In 2017, we opened the £45 million phase one of the new Royal Edinburgh Hospital, and last October, the £69 million East Lothian Community Hospital was completed. There's also been the construction of the new Sick Kids Hospital, which is already hosting services, and that's going to be completed imminently. And we're spending over £20 million on upgrading the Edinburgh Cancer Care, the Cancer Centre. So I would absolutely refute any suggestion that NHS Lothian isn't receiving its share of infrastructure investment. And drawing to a conclusion, Presiding Officer, again, I would just highlight and reiterate that the way eye care services are delivered is changing, and that will continue to change. We're moving further and faster towards convenient care, which is closer to home, wherever that's possible. And the measures I've outlined will improve those services for patients and deliver care closer to their homes. We have a responsibility to ensure that our investments are future-proof, and that sometimes means that these kinds of expensive infrastructure projects just aren't the right investment to make. but we will continue to work closely with NHS Lothian to make sure that eye care services are provided effectively and to get waiting times down as soon as it's safe to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.